learn how to chant the holy names of a baby crying for its mother. Sometimes when we're sitting in class and babies cry, we become annoyed. We think it's a great disturbance. Have any of you ever had that experience? Krishna may be teaching us a more valuable lesson in that cry than we're learning in the class. Because when a baby cries for mother, she knows no other shelter. She realizes her dependence on the mother. The day babies in danger, baby is confident, I can't do it on my own. Baby doesn't call the fire department or the police department or the military. Cries for mother. And Draupadi, when she was in that assembly of the gurus, what magical feat did you just have? So easy to unplug. But we can learn from every situation. Even those things that are disturbing to us. If we're seeking wisdom, Krishna will reveal wisdom in those situations. Draupadi was helpless. She had strength. She had prestige. She had heroic husbands. Nothing was there to help her when she was at the moment of her greatest need. She cried out Krishna's names, "Hey Krishna, hey Govinda," just like a baby in danger cries for mother. And Krishna appeared and delivered her form of a beautiful, unending cloth sari. Krishna embraced her with his grace. This is the teaching of the acharyas, especially Srimad Bhagavatam. How to find Krishna in whatever situation comes in our life. How to transform crisis into blessings. How to transform tragedies into benedictions. How to transform challenges into stepping stones for higher consciousness. Little Dhruva was just a 5-year-old boy. And he was doing what any 5-year-old boy would want to do. Find the approval, the affection of his father. A regular old day at the palace. It's like any other day. Little Dhruva was playing and he wanted to be with his father so bad. His father was sitting on the throne, and little Dhruva crawled up to climb onto his lap. And suddenly, his stepmother, Suruchi, screamed at him. Such a harsh, nasty voice. You have no right to sit on the throne with your father, because you are born of another woman. If you want ever this privilege, you must die and take your next birth in my womb. So he looked at his father for shelter. This was painful. But his father did nothing. His father did not want to please his wife. He had two wives. A lot of complications. That's his wife. Don't try it. Either way. So Dhruva felt totally betrayed. And for a human psyche, this is one of the most painful sufferings of the heart, is to feel betrayed by somebody that you have trusted. Betrayed by someone that you placed as a vulnerable essence of the heart, your love. And a five-year-old child, he had nowhere else. He was mortified. He looked at his father with such innocent desperation. Is it true that I'm such a useless piece of trash? I'm just like a piece of garbage to be spit out because I'm born of somebody else's womb? Is that true, Father? Are you going to help me? The father looked away, confirming everything the stepmother said. The father, you know, men have this male ego sometimes. Usually women can detect it better than us because it's our ego. But anyways, that's a long story. He really didn't think that much of it. He thought, oh, now my wife is acting like this and my son is just... He didn't realize that his neglecting his son totally tore his heart to pieces. Dhruva began to cry and he ran. He ran to his mother. Which Dhruva couldn't even speak. He was heaving, breathing so deep. Heaving in anguish. Hot tears pouring out of his eyes. Lips trembled. He could not speak a word. And somebody from the palace told her what happened. And when she saw her son in this state, a loving mother seeing a five-year-old child in this condition, betrayed, broken-hearted, lost, desperate. Her face became like a lotus flower, shriveled by the burning sun. She lost her heart. Said, Dhruva, unfortunately, it's true. Your father doesn't favor me. when actually what your stepmother said is true. She told you, if you take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, if you pray to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to the Lord, then you could die and take birth from her womb. Take the good from that. All your desires could be fulfilled if you just take shelter of the Lord. She found a bit of wisdom, even in the most angry, sage statement, where there was no intention of wisdom. It was that I want a kingdom greater than my father or my grandfather. My mother said, by taking shelter of Lord Krishna, all our desires could be fulfilled. Great sages since time immemorial have found that shelter by going to the forest. Shobha didn't say another word. He ran out of the palace, ran out of the kingdom, ran into the forest, deeper, deeper, deeper. He ran so fast nobody knew what he was doing or could follow. We were talking about what forests were like those days. Tigers, elephants, lions, leopards, panthers, snakes, mosquitoes, a lot of nice lizards. He was born and raised in a beautiful palatial building with all luxuries. And now he's living alone as a 5-year-old boy. And he ran into the darkest places of the forest where no humans would dare to tread. He was seeking God. Such determination. When the father found out about it, he sent people out to try to find Dhruva, but he was gone. And then he realized what he had done. Another element of human nature. Sometimes due to our attachments, sometimes due to our egos, we don't realize what we're doing till there's a disaster. And we start rethinking, what did I say? What didn't I say? He was devastated. I did this to my son. My little beautiful son, I hurt him so bad that he rejected home to live in the jungle. Parents, how would you feel about that? Hurt your child so bad at that age, they reject everything. The Krishna's in the heart of every living thing. He knows our, he knows the sincerity of our purpose. So Krishna, he sent his devotee, Narayana, into the forest to show them the way to Krishna. Because Dhruva didn't know anything. He was just in the jungle looking for Krishna. He didn't know what to do. And Narayana appeared in the most unlikely place. And he told Dhruva, why are you so disturbed? You know, you're just a child. So you get insulted, go home, play, forget about it, you'll get over it. He started telling him about how saintly people are not disturbed by praise or blame. And Dhruva listened. And he said, whatever you say is true. but it doesn't touch my heart. I'm hurt too bad. Your philosophy doesn't reach my heart. What is the use of philosophy unless it touches your heart? And Narada Muni told him, okay, I will tell you how to find Krishna. You are definitely sincere. And that's what he initiated Rupa. He gave him the mantra. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Paint walls. How is this God? Krishna promises. Bhaktaram pushpam balam toyam yami bhakta prayachit. If something is offered to me with love and devotion, I accept. And one time Prabhupada was challenged, how could Krishna be in a deity? Krishna's everywhere. Krishna's everywhere, why are you worshipping deity? The Prabhupada said, if Krishna's everywhere, then he's also in the deity. But we can focus our total love and devotion in making an offering. It's hard to do that to everywhere. Yes? But we fulfill. When you water the root of the tree, you water everyone in the tree. When Krishna is satisfied, we fulfill everything. A little drummer just had a little muddy duties. Drying the sun, we would offer flowers and leaves and so many things. And after some time, he became so advanced in the yoga process, he didn't even drink water, or leaves, or fruits. He just breathed. Through the yogic process in very advanced stages, you can develop the siddhi, the perfection, where you can extract all the vitamins, minerals, proteins, nutrients, everything your body needs from the air by breathing. That'd be incredible. But it's not as nice as eating good prasad. By Gopinath. And he developed in his chanting of this mantra and performing. He was so intense, so determined. After some time, he stopped even breathing. And he performed a very difficult asana. He stood on one toe. Maybe I'd like to try that. He wasn't like a ballerina. He was standing on one toe. And his body was as immovable as a stone pillar. Not a single limb moved even slightly as he stood on his toes without breathing. And he was like that for weeks, totally immersed, according to Narada Muni's instruction, on meditation, the beautiful world of the heart, within his heart. And as he chanted, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, and was worshipping the beautiful form of the Lord within his heart in his meditation, something incredible happened. It wasn't on the basis of his austerity. It wasn't on the basis of his renunciation. It was on the basis of his sincerity. He was expressing his sincerity through this process. But Vishnu, Lord Narayan, actually appeared within his heart. Dhruva, whose eyes were closed, who was standing like this, on a toe, was seeing the Lord within his heart. All of his desires, all of his anxieties, everything disappears. Krishna Surya Sam Mayohaya Andhaka. In the presence of the sun, darkness cannot exist. Anxiety, fear, misery, envy and greed, all this stuff, it's just byproducts of darkness. It can't cannot exist in the Son. He is an ecstasy. Totally absorbed in drinking the nectar of the Lord's form through his open, intimate love of his heart. Suddenly, Krishna disappeared from his heart. This is called Sambhog and Vipralamba. He became so deeply, deeply attached to the Lord when the Lord disappeared. He couldn't continue his meditation. In that shock, after weeks, he opened his eyes. And what he saw was a great miracle. The same exact form of the Lord that he was worshiping with his love in his heart was now physically standing right in front of him. And he was seeing them with these eyes. First he was seeing him with his eyes closed inside. Now he's seeing him with his eyes open outside. And the Drupal was only 5 years old. Usually you start school around 5 or 6. So he was not educated yet. He wanted to offer beautiful prayers. But he didn't know poetry, he didn't know Sanskrit much. He wanted to express so many words of gratitude and love through his, what was in his heart. Krishna understood his desire and smiled. He took his conch shell and placed it on Drupa's head. Just touch it. And in doing so, empower Drupa to be able to verbalize the feelings of his heart, the wisdom that was revealed to him. Drupa offered beautiful poetic prayers. Even now, ages and ages and ages later, great scholars, yogis, saints, devotees recite these prayers as a great source of inspiration and knowledge. Magnificent Sanskrit poetry. With such philosophical precision and such pure spiritual emotion. And this little 5-year-old boy in the jungle. And the Lord was so pleased with Drupa. He said, I will fulfill your desire. You came to the forest because you wanted a kingdom greater than your father or grandfather. I will give it to you. Just ask. And Dhruva Maharaj replied, I came looking for broken pieces of glass. But by your grace, I have attained the most precious diamond. Once experiencing the love, the grace, the sweetness, and the beauty of the Supreme Personality of God, even the greatest fortunes of kingdoms and powers and wealth had no more value than broken pieces of glass. Sometimes, if glass is like a bottle or something, you can get a deposit or a refund maybe in the old days. But what can you do with the broken pieces of glass? In fact, they're dangerous. They cut you. But the love for Krishna, to feel that, to feel Krishna's love, and to awaken our love, and to have that enthusiasm to serve, that is a priceless, precious time. In fact, Lord Chaitanya called Prema Bhakti the Purusharta Siromani. It means the crest jewel of all perfections in life. Just 3 days ago, I was in the British Museum. How I got there was kind of strange. You don't mind if I defer from the story? University of London Division to meet a professor, Balaram Sapura's name. Just giving a class at this Radhanath Swami temple. The first marble deities of all of this time. The Srila Prabhupada rescued. And so I was with Radhanath Swami on that very holy day of Balaram Jayanti. Met a professor, and I was taking a walk with some two devotees, and we decided to go to the place Radhanath and Ishwar were first installed. A street in the Camden section of London called Berry Street. Is that where you became a devotee, at Berry Street?
No.
After?
No, I was in Buckingham.
Well, Berry Street is a five-story, very thin building. And it's incredible how that happened. I'm going to divert from this story and come back to this story. And then eventually, hopefully, I'll get back to the original story. But I may get more diversions in the way. But Mukunda Maharaj, he met Prabhupada with his wife at the time, Janaki. They met Prabhupada in the Bowery. He was living in just a loft in the Bowery, which was in those days a serious ghetto of New York City. And they somehow or other went to hear Prabhupada speak. And then the person,
that's
a little close, actually.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, I was talking about Balaram Jayanti, and Baladev came to see me. Second Avenue, a little storefront. And then Mukunda Maharaj had some friend named Shamsundar. His name was Sam in those days. And he was living in California with his girlfriend, Malati. And he said to Prabhupada, you know, the Lower East Side is a good place. Hey, Ashbury will be a great place. That was like the Mecca for hippies. Prabhupada said, yes, go start a center there. So Mukunda Maharaj went and he joined his friend Shamsundar, and then Yamuna Devi, she was a friend of Shamsundar from the same little town of Salem, Oregon, from their early childhood. When you see these devotees, these really senior devotees, especially these ones, come together, really, really sweet. Yamuna Devi, she was ill last, of course she passed away. One of the most precious. precious souls in the history of this world. She passed away last year. But earlier, she was in our Bhaktivedanta hospital in Bombay for about 4 months. And Shamsuri Prabhu spends a lot of time with us there, Radha Gopinatha. So we went together to see Yamuna. And they started talking about old times. They were talking about their services to Prabhupada and what incredible services they did for Prabhupada together. Unbelievable. They started San Francisco, they started London, they started India. Shamsundar Prabhu was Prabhupada's person. Secretary Yamuna Devi was Prabhupada's person. Guru Das, Mukunda Maharaj, Janaki, what they were doing. So Shamsundar was reminding Yamuna, do you remember when we were in grade school together? How we always talked about spiritual topics and nobody else was interested except the two of us. He said, and Yamuna would have the seat right in front of Shamsundar, and she had pigtails. And Shamsundar, without her knowing, would tie her pigtail hair, braided hair, braids, I don't know what to call them here, but he would tie her braids to the back of her chair. With her little holes where you pick up the chairs with in case I need to move them. And she didn't know. And then when the class was over and everyone had to leave, she would like stand up. And the teacher was, why are you making noise in the class? She would get her in so many, she would always get her in trouble. And they were laughing. They went back that far. Anyways, they started in San Francisco. They had a big mantra rock dance where they got all the biggest bands in America to come and play for free to help raise funds for Srila Prabhupada's new little storefront, which is about a third the size of this room. And one day, I saw this letter. Srila Prabhupada writes a letter to Mukunda, now he's Goswami, and said, Shamsundar wrote me a letter and said he would like to go to London to bring the Beatles to Krishna consciousness. He said, I think it's a good idea. What do you think? This is how they thought in those days. They were really, as they say, out of the box. Now, how many of you are from those days of the Beatles? Well, at a certain point, they were so popular, they were so famous in America, in England, in Germany, anywhere they went, that wherever they went, there would be thousands of people screaming hysterically and trying to touch them, whatever. They were the first rock and roll band to play in a stadium. That was historical. Shea Stadium in New York City. And the people, there were tens of, I think, like 30, 40,000 people, I don't know how many there were, but they were all screaming. And they couldn't even hear themselves playing. And you know, it was kind of depressing for them because, you know, they're musicians. They've come to share the art of their music. You know, they're spending their lives writing songs and practicing, and everybody's screaming so loud, nobody cared about their music. So it came to the point where they made no public appearances. They would just make great songs and record them in studios, and that was all. Nobody could meet the Beatles. Their first record in America was Meet the Beatles. But after some time, no one was allowed to meet the Beatles. So
Well, they were the hardest people in the world to meet. And they went to London. They had no money.
Do you all know the story, how they got in? If any of you read The Journey Home, it was really difficult to get in London in those days. I took a flight to Luxembourg. It was $65. It was a stop in Iceland. And we had no money, myself and my friend, Mary. And we didn't know where to go. We didn't know anybody. Our friend, who was supposed to be sponsoring us, got robbed and he left the first day. So we met some people from Amsterdam. They came up to us because they thought we looked pretty strange. We had long hair, and they had long hair. And they never met long-haired people from America. So we were kind of like, I guess, cool. And their eyes, anyway. We weren't actually my friends. Possibilities. This is to show you that they don't like you. That's the way I grew up as a teenager, being harassed like that by authorities. Just because you're making a statement that they don't like by growing your hair long. And we got there, I said, you know, I have my passport, and it was pretty official. And we stopped, and we looked at immigration. They looked at us really seriously. And then they started laughing at me. And from that day, I fell in love with Belgium. And to me, after they just smiled and waved and said, have a nice time, welcome to our country, I was thinking that the people of Belgium are like residents of the spiritual world. Then we drove through, and ultimately we came to Abkouda.
Abkouda.
It's a little village in those days, in Holland. And my friend lived there. And his mother, she started giving us all kinds of chocolates and stuff like that, and pastries. We were really happy. When you don't have anything, you really appreciate things. And then we went to spend some time, then hitchhiked down to Rotterdam, then down to the Hook of Holland, and we took the ferry across the English Channel to England. And when we got there, it was nothing like Belgium. They took us in a private room and started screaming at us and shouting at us and
threatening us and telling us, where is your money? And we had no money. And they started screaming. And they said they took out razor blades and said, we're going to cut your hair. We're going to put you in prison. We're going to punish you. You can't come into this country without money. And after saying that, they walked out. And we're sitting there. They're just teenagers. Then about an hour later, they grabbed us and pushed us outside. And we were in England. Very hospitality oriented, I think. So anyways, getting back to the story. At least one of the stories. They wanted to go out. They got this airplane. They tell the stories about the different airplanes they took. But anyways, they were in Amsterdam. And they were trying to get in England. But they heard stories that you're not allowed in unless you have money. And they had no money. And there's six of them. Three couples. Shamsundar Malati, Guru Das Yamuna, Chadaki and Kunda Goswami. Where did they get money? So they wrote to Shri, they sent Prabhupada a telegram. Can you lend us $100? Something like $100. So Prabhupada sent them a telegram, Western Union, whatever, with $100. So one of the couples went. They went to immigration. They showed him $100. They said, yes, you can come. As soon as they got out of immigration, they went to Western Union, gave them $100, sent it back to Amsterdam. Then the second couple came in. Said, how much money do you have? We have $100. They went through immigration, sent by Western Union to the next. The third couple came in. And after they all got in, they went to Western Union and sent it back to Srila Prabhupada. And they didn't know where to live, they didn't know anybody for a while. I was once with Shamsundar and Guru Das together in London, and they were showing me some of the places they stayed. They were in one kind of a basement of a warehouse, and Auntie and her little baby Saraswati and Shamsundar were living in a cardboard box that used to hold a refrigerator. In a warehouse basement. And they were happy because they were there for problems. And they said one day it snowed, and when they got out of the box, they were covered in snow. They got inside. Anyways, it's a long story. But the conclusion of this particular story is that a few weeks later, they're living in John Lennon's house, daily talking to all the Beatles and their wives. Anymore. It was a little late, maybe some months later, actually. And they invited Prabhupada. Prabhupada was living there with them. And they got this place in a very place, and they were trying to, Shamsundar was trying to fix it up. He was a carpenter. And there, in that little building, it's still there today. Srila Prabhupada installed the first marble deities of ISKCON, Radhanath and Ishvara. And Krishna consciousness just exploded in London. There were hundreds of people becoming devotees. And the devotees, George Harrison helped them make a record with the Beatles label of Apple Records. And the Hare Krishna mantra, sung by Yamuna Devi, was the number one song on the charts in Europe. Govindam
Adi Purusham and the Radha Krishna album was one of the top selling record albums. So people were inviting them to play concerts all over Europe. And they were just singing kirtan. People loved it. There was a show in London called The Pop of the Tops. Top of the Pop. Top of the Tops. Top of the Pops. It was a very famous show. And Sham Sundar Prabhu told me that one time George was watching television and he saw the devotees on the top. And George Harrison said he started to cry. He said it was the happiest moment of his life.
That's right.
He said he felt more happy seeing the devotees on television chanting Hare Krishna than he ever felt when the Beatles were making number one hits and making albums and playing to big stadiums. He was really the devotee. Because he knew how much Krishna was pleased. So they moved in this place at Berry Street. And one day George Harrison came there and it was so overcrowded because there were, from what I was told, actually on my way back from India, I stopped there. And I remember it was so crowded. This was in 1972. Dhananjaya Prabhu was the president. Dayananda Prabhu was there. The devotees were sleeping on the stairs. And I think I was sleeping on a stair. I was sleeping in a little area between the two stairs going down. So George came to see Prabhupada once and he saw all these devotees. He felt that devotees should have a better life. Prabhupada asked, could you help? So George, he bought Bhaktivedanta Manor for the devotees. He sponsored Prabhupada's Krishna book when they had no money. Just because, you know, these six devotees, they had enthusiasm. They weren't, we have to calculate things practically, but sometimes our enthusiasm should go beyond that. We have to do that. We shouldn't be limited to that. This is the result. Bhaktivedanta Manor, Barry's place, books being printed, record albums, number one sellers. And they came there just with an idea that was impossible. They had nothing but, when they came to that country, they had nothing but enthusiasm. No money, no contacts. That's the way Prabhupada came to America in 1965. So I went and looked at Berry Place. And now, because the devotees, if they were, I think, renting it, they gave it up long, long ago. And now it is an office for dentists. And it says, there's a sign of it, dental offices. And as I was looking at it a few days ago, I was thinking, it went from being transcendental to now being really dental. And then we walked a little more. And we came to the British Museum, which is only less than a block away from the Berry Place Temple. And that was a huge museum. One of the devotees I was with, I said, have you been in the British Museum? I said, I don't remember being in there. He
said, would you like to go in? I said, no, I'm happy outside. But then, somehow or other, he took me in. And a few minutes later, I'm looking at the mummy form of Cleopatra. Have any of you seen Cleopatra? Anyway, she's there. At least your body's there. What's left of it? There's this box, and it has like a painting of her on top of it, and then inside is her mummy form. They don't open it, but they have like seen what they call them scan X-rays, where you can see inside, and she's like a skeleton laying there. Anyways, if you look at her now, she's not as beautiful as the history books. But according to that, she died when she was 17 years and 9 months old. She made history very young. So now I'm going to get back to the story. Which story? As I was there in the British Museum, I was seeing, after seeing Cleopatra and the Egyptian mummies and everything, there was some wonderful deities and jewels from India. And it's a saying that the wealth of India is now in the British Museum. Because when the British, for I think about 200 years, they ruled over India, and they really took everything they could and brought it to London. So when Srila Prabhupada came to London in 1969, some press reporters challenged him. They said, why have you come to our country? Srila Prabhupada said, well, you came to our country. He said, during the British rule, you took all the treasures and all the fortunes of India to bring it to London. He said, but the greatest treasure in all of our India is our spiritual culture. I have come to give you what you forgot to take. Very comprehensive. Yes, the Kohinoor jewel and all these beautiful jewels and diamonds. They took them from deities' crowns of South Vishnu and Krishna, deities of South India. They took these beautiful jewels. But the Purushantha Siromani, the crest jewel, the most precious, valuable of all jewels, is Prema Bhakti. Prema Kumarta Mahan. The greatest of all goals of life, greater than artha, kama, dhamma, moksha, is the awakening of that ecstatic love for Krishna within our heart. And when that love was awakened in little Dhruva's heart, he saw that all the things that people are struggling for and striving for and fighting for and having wars over, compared to Krishna, it's all broken glass. It's very difficult to overcome the attractions and the aversions of this world.
But when we experience the higher taste, when we experience the eternal treasure of the heart, when we experience the value of that jewel of bhakti, it's so great that we see everything else for what it is. We can utilize things to express our love, but we don't need things. We utilize them for a purpose. We need them to a certain extent, but not for our happiness. It is said that in a spiritually cultured society, people use things and love people. But in a spiritually weak society, people love things and use people. That's the problem.
Yes.
The little dream of our age attained the ultimate perfection of life at 5 years old, simply because of his enthusiasm. And the incredible thing is, if he didn't go through that crisis of being insulted and betrayed, he would have just happily lived ever after in his palace. Prince Druva, he would have grew up, he would have got married, and we would have never heard his name. So, by the wisdom of his mother, and by the grace of Krishna, and by his own sincerity, he transformed the most unbearable disaster into the greatest blessing. To see every situation as opportunities is actually the quality of real greatness. When things go our way and we do all right, that's not real greatness. But when we see opportunities when things are going right, and when things are really in a reversal state that are incomprehensible and even painful, that is great. And that is Krishna consciousness. To be conscious of Krishna in these situations. Whatever, I have the chance to serve, I have the chance to call on his name like that little baby crying for the mother. Let's change the dental into the transcendental. Sometimes material life is like a tool. Lord Krishna told little 5-year-old Dhruva, now you should go home and be with your father and mother and forgive your stepmother. She's just a little crazy. She's an illusion. But you should love her and take care of her. Dhruva, he had no animosity. He went back and forgave everyone. And when he came back, his father was so happy. And Dhruva gradually, he grew up and he became the king. He had a wife, he had children. He had such serious responsibilities. His father retired, made him the emperor. Dhruva was the ruler. All the people. But how did he rule? Because of that connection of his eternal soul, because of his love for Krishna, Ahambija Pratavita, Krishna tells the Gita, I am the father and mother of every living being. to our side, that every citizen, male, female, whatever their color, whatever their race, whatever their economic, social position, whatever their species, wherever there's life, there is a sacred part of God. And as the king, I must serve every living being as a part of God. On behalf of Krishna, I must protect them, inspire them, empower them. And that's what he did. What a wonderful kingdom it was. There was no scarcity, because there was no greed. Yad kadoshi yadashnasi yadjohoshi yadasi yad. I'm sorry. All that you offer and give away, do it for me. Krishna tells in Gita that what great people do, becoming people follow. Because Dhruva loved everyone as a natural expression of his love for Krishna. Everyone loved each other. And when Dhruva got older and his children were old enough, he left home to go back into the forest after coronating his own son as king. And he did it in an extremely responsible way, so there would be continuity, succession. And then he went to Bhagavad Gashram. Have any of you been to Bhagavad Gashram? Yes, have you been there? Bhagavad Gashram? We have a Bhagavad Gashram there. Should I divert again? In Bhadrak Ashram, Lord Vishnu descended to earth in such high peaks of the Himalayas. And Lakshmi Devi, seeing her beloved Narayan in this cold Himalayan mountaintop, she incarnated as a Bhadri tree. And she would give him shade in the, from the sun. And she would warm him in the winter. And she would produce fruits. And he was just sitting doing tapasya meditation in the Padmasana. And she would just drop little fruits right in front of him. So it's called Bhadrinath. Bhadri is the name of Lakshmi, because she was a Bhadri tree. And Bhadrinath means the Lord of Lakshmi. So Dhruva went up there, and there is the Alaknanda River, which later becomes the Ganga River, Ganges. And he was just living with all these sages and rishis, totally immersed in his life, in chanting Krishna's names and meditating on Krishna. And when it came time, one day in the morning, a beautiful airplane from the spiritual world by Kuntha came down. And two spiritual personalities came off and said, Dhruva, we have been sent to bring you to the spiritual world. You have already attained the ultimate perfection in this life, and now your eternal soul will come to enjoy the loving pastimes of the Lord forever. It's so instructive what Dhruva did at that point. If we listen carefully, it will deeply affect our hearts as well as the whole way that we reason. Dhruva was being elevated to the highest spiritual perfection. And he told him to wait. And he did his spiritual practices, his sadhana.
chanted the mantras. He worships his deity. He did his meditation. Because you see, he was doing it for the pleasure of the Lord. We do our sadhana in the beginning stages to clean our heart. But when our heart is actually clean, we do the same sadhana as an expression of our ecstatic love. Srila Prabhupada once asked me, what do you hope to achieve by chanting Hare Krishna? Well, most people would say we will achieve heavenly pleasures, or we will achieve liberation, or we will achieve entrance into the spiritual world. Prabhupada gave such an incredible answer. He said the goal of chanting Hare Krishna is to chant Hare Krishna. What does that mean? We're chanting Hare Krishna now to please Radharani and Krishna. Now we're doing it because if we please them, they will clean our heart and we will awaken love. But when that love awakens, then we will chant Hare Krishna out of pure ecstatic love to please Krishna. It's eternal. So Dhruva completed his sadhana because his sadhana was an air of love. And then he went to each and every sage, Rishi and Yogi, that was there, and honored them and worshiped them and asked for their blessings. Now, he was perfect. He wasn't necessarily perfect. Most of us, you know, yogis and sages, Rishis all over the place, you know, there's not that many there, but most of us, if the airplane was waiting to take us to the Vaikuntha, then we'd be thinking, you know, I'm glad I'm it's too bad you're not going, but I'm going. Dhruva was in such a superior position. He had perfection and the others didn't. But the natural quality in his heart was to take a lower position and beg for their blessings, honor them, and worship them. You see, that's why he's so elevated. Amani Namanade. That's the quality that makes him so great. If he wasn't like that, the Vaikuntha airship wouldn't come for him. And he wasn't pretending. It was genuine, from the heart. He had no false ego. He wanted to thank everyone for what they did for him. Now, some of us would really be intoxicated. I'm going back home, back to God. I'm on a special airplane. It's like a chartered flight because it's helping me on it. You know? The Dhruva, after stepping on the ship, he felt a certain experience in his heart. Please listen carefully. He was thinking, how could I go without my mother? After all, it was her words that I should worship Krishna that put me on the path from the very beginning. I owe her everything. How could I go and leave my mother behind? Such gratitude. His mother wasn't there. Narada Muni was his guru. He was already a liberated soul. His mother wasn't a great sage. We read about how she was deeply affected by the material circumstances. This happened so long before. Now he's an elderly man, and he's remembering when he was 5 years old. He
but she helped. This is another quality of a great devotee. Gratitude. We never forget who has helped us. In big ways, in small ways. When we're grateful to those people who help us to come closer to Krishna, that is a profound, necessary expression of expressing our gratitude to Krishna. And that's the way Krishna sees it. Showing honor and gratitude to my devotee, Krishna says, pleases me more than if you do it for me. So Dhruva was thinking, my poor mother, what about her? She's the one who opened the door to bhakti. And the two residents of the spiritual world who were there with Dhruva, they smiled. They said, Dhruva, look. And he looked up, and there was another airplane to the spiritual world with his mother on it. They already knew his heart. She did not have the qualification. But by the love of a pure devotee, she was given entrance before him by his prayer. And Srila Prabhupada, in his great humility, and when great souls speak like this, with such deep humility, it's very inconceivable. Because on one level, they mean it. Because that's the nature of ecstatic love for Krishna, it's this humble state. On another level, they're revealing how the qualities, the characteristics we should cultivate. Srila Prabhupada said in his purport, he writes, that just as Suniti, the mother, attained spiritual perfection in the spiritual world by the power of Dhruva's devotion, because she helped him. Prabhupada said, I am praying that one or more of my disciples will become so spiritually advanced that by their devotion I can go to the spiritual world too. Prabhupada's thanking all of us, and yet he's thinking of her. What does it mean to be a devotee? Learn to your subject. Thank you very much.
Jai.
Srila Prabhupada,
Jai.
Radhanath Swami,
Jai.